I haven't been able in my own spirit to hold back in terms of anticipation of this morning and getting into this series, which really began last Sunday, Easter Sunday, and will go on all the way to Pentecost, so across the next 6 weeks, dealing with Because He Lives. You know the hymn, Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow. We're going to be singing that as we close our worship service. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, life is worth the living just because He lives. We've celebrated Jesus is alive. I'm going to have you do that acclamation with me, that Easter acclamation again. I am going to say, Alleluia, Christ is risen. And you are going to say, the Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. There you go. It's on the screen for you. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen again. Alleluia. He is. He's present and alive right here. And one of the amazing things is this, that because He is alive, you can trust God's Word. And that's the substance of our time here together this morning. Because He is alive, you can absolutely and altogether trust God's Word, the Bible. Turn to page 6 in your service sheet, or even better than that, turn to page 1139 in the Bibles that are in the pews, or better than that, turn in your own Bible to Luke chapter 24. That's the closing chapter of Luke, and there you've got Jesus coming back to life and meeting with a couple of disciples who are walking to Emmaus. Now, it may well be that US Airways is opening up a route, as they say, from Philadelphia to Tel Aviv this coming year. Tel Aviv being the airport of Israel. And it may well be that, and I feel and long for the day when I can take a group of you again to the Holy Land so that you can walk where Jesus walked. If that happens, you will note as you move from Tel Aviv, which is not that far from Jerusalem, in the bus ride that we will take, a sign that points off of the highway to Emmaus. And you'll go nuts like I did the first time I saw that. Because here in Luke 24, there were two disciples making their way from Jerusalem to Emmaus, about a Sabbath day's walk, it's said to be. That is the distance you could walk if you were Jewish and keeping the law concerning how far you could travel on the Sabbath day. Now, they're walking along, talking with each other, these two, commiserating with broken hearts about their sadness at the death of Jesus and the events of the last few days in Jerusalem. And as they're walking and talking, Jesus walks in beside them. And they're stopped from recognizing, by some miracle or other, that it is Jesus who's walking with them. And Jesus asks them the question, what is this that you're talking about as you travel together? And they said, are you the only person in Jerusalem who doesn't know what's happened in the last few days? Let me tell you something. He was the one person who really knew what had happened in the last few days. But they weren't aware that it was Jesus. So they asked him that question. And that's where we pick up the text, because his response to them was quite extraordinary in the first place. Verse 25 of Luke 24, it says this. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken." So he kind of steps in. He's the Lord. He's got this prerogative and says, "You're talking like fools. You're dense of heart. You're so slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken." Now, if I were Jesus and I wanted them to be convinced about the resurrection, I'd just say, "Look, this is really me." But he didn't do that. This became a very significant teaching moment for Jesus to instruct the disciples, those two, and instruct us here this morning. Because having admonished them for being slow and dense, like having closed spiritual eyes for whatever information they had about the Bible, as they've been brokenhearted and talking about Jesus and the events that had taken place in Jerusalem, he saw that they didn't have a living, vibrant faith. But in teaching them, look at what he says. "How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken." So verse 26, "Did not the Christ," that is the Messiah, "have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." And what Jesus began to do, as he will with us now, is reassert that the things that happened to him had to happen because he was the Messiah, and the Messiah had to die and be raised again, as spoken of. And he taught them all the way through Moses and the prophets, the whole of the Old Testament. That was all the Bible they had in those days. The New Testament had yet to be written. He taught them from Moses and the prophets all the things concerning himself. And in so doing, was teaching them the authority of the Word of God. And that these things had to be so concerning himself, because the Word of God said so. And so he, Jesus, is teaching these followers to get their heads and their hearts into God's Word, to have their eyes and their hearts opened to what the Word said concerning himself. Martin Luther said this, when people would talk about defending the Word of God, he'd say, "You may as well try and defend a lion. All you've got to do is let the lion out of the cage. The lion can look after itself." And in some sense, what we've got to do is get this Lion of Judah, this Word of God, out of the cage of unknowing and out there into the open, where you can appreciate what it has to say and trust it as God's word to you. Look at what he goes on to say. Because he not only began to teach them that these things should be so concerning himself, but later on, verse 32, he says, "They say," as they asked each other, Jesus now having disappeared from sight, "were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" Boys, that is a Bible study I would love to be a part of. To have Jesus himself open up the scriptures. And for us to observe what he had to say and learn from him. Not just to get information in our heads, but have his spirit witnessing with our spirits so that our hearts are burning within us, like we're on fire on the inside. So here is Jesus teaching the Bible, And they are consumed on the inside with a desire to express joy and energy and a response to God, that they use the words, our hearts were on fire. And they're both saying it to themselves and to each other as Jesus opened up the word to them. Now, if you've got the Bible open, and if you don't, then you'll need to make reference of this. Later in the same passage, he turns up with all the disciples. These two went running back to Jerusalem and said, it's really true. Jesus is alive. And it's like they're all hubbubbing together, because as they run in amongst the disciples, the other disciples are saying, it's true, Jesus is alive. He's appeared to Peter and then to some others. So there's like this a celebration that Jesus is alive as they're chatting back and forth. And suddenly, Jesus is there amongst them. And then listen to what it has to say. Verse 44, he said to them, this is what I told you while I was with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. The law of Moses is the first five books, the prophets and the Psalms. He speaks about the whole of the Old Testament bearing witness to him. And he said, I taught this to you while I was with you. Do you see that? This is what I told you while I was with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Then it says in verse 45, he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. This is what is written. That is in the Old Testament. Well, you remember last week, the Apostle Paul teaching 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And this is the passage we looked at. And it was all I could do not to go to these words, where he says, I delivered to you, this is the Apostle Paul now writing to Corinth, I delivered to you as of first importance what I'd also received, that Christ died for our sins, in my Bible I've then got underlined, according to the scriptures, that he was buried and rose again on the third day, and again it says, according to the scriptures. Here is Jesus himself in Luke teaching us and teaching his disciples that the things that happened to him had to happen to him according to the scriptures. And what Jesus is authenticating is the authority of the Old Testament as the Word of God. And it is because he, Jesus, lives that we now know and can trust this to be the Word of God. Because Jesus walked from the grave alive, taught his disciples concerning that Old Testament word, and because Jesus is alive, gives to us the confidence that this is the Word of God and absolutely trustworthy. He trusted it, taught from it, alluded to it, lived his life by it, and proclaimed it, and explained his death and resurrection by preaching and teaching from it to his disciples. Do you know what good news this is? That you have a word of authority by which to know what is right and what is wrong. The great experience we need is to come to his word, yield our hearts and minds to it, have the Spirit of God teach us from it so that our hearts burn within us. It's not for nothing that I pray when we begin this time together, take my lips and speak through them, take our minds and think through them, take our wills and bend them to your own, and take our hearts and set them on fire with love for yourself. Not because I'm up here saying words, but because if Jesus Christ takes his word and speaks through my lips to you, and you yield to his word, then you can walk out of here with your heart burning. And some of you, even as you're sitting there, are saying, wow, that's what's going on in me. That's what's happening to me. No wonder I'm excited. It's not about the chap upon the platform speaking. It's about God taking his word and applying it to my heart and my life and encouraging me to believe it and inspiring me. So those words that I pray are real. And it doesn't just happen here in church when we preach. But what I'm encouraging you to do, and that's the thrust of this, that if Jesus is alive, gives us every confidence that God's word is true and real and as true today as it was then, and Jesus has authenticated it and walked out of the grave alive, having said that he would, and teaching us from his word that it must be so, you have a word to base your life upon that you can come to, and as you surrender to that word, have God set your heart on fire as a response to his truth and the power of his truth in your life, you. And this can happen at home or at work if you've got a Bible there, or at school as you take a Bible with you and not just your school books. To stop and take a breather and take a look at the Word of God and see what he has to say to you. God's Word is a living Word. When I first became a believer, my first ministry was to offer to teach some brat boys. That's not as they were described, but that's what they turned out to be in a Sunday school class. And the whole Sunday school class met and sang some choruses together before we divided up into our various age groups and classes. And there was a song that we used to sing, "Break thou the bread of life, dear Lord, to me, as you did break the loaves by Galilee." To have Jesus come and break the bread of life for you and feed you and nourish you is the great gift of the Scriptures. Now what's astounding is that when you go back over the Gospels, you find that Jesus lived his life by them. So that, for instance, as he began his ministry, he was driven into the wilderness, went through the temptations. That's how we began Lent. So he was for 40 days and 40 nights hungering and fasting, and Satan came and tempted him. And with each temptation, Jesus said, "It is written," as a response to those temptations, and then quoted the word of God to the devil. That's Jesus, who's nourished himself, knows what the word of God says. So when temptation comes, he's able to quote the word of God back to the devil. Because a fat lot of good it does, quoting the word to the devil. But it's great and encouraging to know that Jesus nourished his own spirit by it. So can you. We're learning those scriptures and memorizing those scriptures. And Psalm 119 and verse 11, you can all say with me, can't you? For those of you who are visiting, we're setting ourselves to memorize a verse a month. And you can go, and if you've lost your card, or if you're visiting, you can go and get a card and memorize these same scriptures. But Psalm 119 verse 11 says this. Say it along with me if you can remember it. "I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." How about that? That's what Jesus had done. Hidden God's word in his heart. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "I haven't come to abolish the law. I have come to fulfill the law and the prophets." Not to abolish them, but to fulfill them. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus stands up in the synagogue in Nazareth. If we get to go to Israel, you can go into this very synagogue, where he undid the scroll. This is right early on in his ministry. He goes back to his hometown, Nazareth. He stands up in this little synagogue, and they bring to him the scriptures, and he unrolls the scroll, and he reads from Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 and 2, concerning the Messiah. And having read those words, he then says this: today, these words have been fulfilled in your hearing. Whoa. He reads the Bible and then says to his audience in Nazareth, this very day, these scriptures, Isaiah 61, have been fulfilled in your hearing. Why? Because Jesus was the Messiah. But he takes them to the Word of God, reads the Word of God, and then says in himself, these words have been fulfilled. So we have this amazing word of truth. Now, there's so much more to be said concerning what Jesus taught about the Old Testament and himself being the fulfillment of it all. But when you come to the Gospels and the balance of the Bible with the epistles and the New Testament, I want you to turn your attention just for a moment to John chapter 14 and verse 25. Because my second major heading here is not only to trust the Old Testament as the Word of God, which is a real challenge for some of you, but to trust the New Testament as the Word of God as well. And Jesus, speaking to his disciples at the Last Supper, that's where this narrative comes from, said this. This is John 14, verse 25. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said. Did you hear that? His promise to his disciples that the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, that's Pentecost to which we are headed, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. That's John 14, 25. What Jesus says to his disciples, because he knows that he's going to die the next day, and then 3 days later walk from the grave alive, and he's given them that teaching, as I've said, and as he said. But in knowing that, he says that when the Holy Spirit comes, the Comforter, he will lead you into all the truth and bring to your remembrance everything that I have taught you. So when you read these Gospels and the Epistles, the New Testament, what you know is that God has given the authority of his blessing from the lips of Jesus Christ, that what you have here is his truth. He will lead you into all the truth. And just like Jesus said, thy word is truth, as he's speaking to the Father, thy word is truth. So that word translated and put into writing through the disciples is God's truth. Therefore, God's truth to us. Therefore, we need to yield to it and bow to it and surrender to it. To memorize God's word, to commit it to memory, to spend time in it morning and evening, to take every opportunity to correct the course of your life and the way you're thinking so that it becomes conformed to the way God wants you to think and feel and behave is a gift of God to you and to me from his word. We're not playing church games in getting you to memorize his word. You've grasped from the teaching of the Lord Jesus that to get that word of truth in a world that's so manipulated, you don't know what to believe. When you come to God's word, you enter the no-spin zone. Some of you know that's Bill O'Reilly's line, that when you enter him, when you enter with him into his whatever length of program it is, he says it's a no spin zone. Well, you wonder whether it is a spin zone or a no spin zone. But when you come to the Word of God, you are entering a no spin zone. You may find yourself reading the Word of God to be critical of the Word of God, and you find that Word of God coming right back at you and criticizing you, and or ministering to you, or encouraging you and inspiring you. I told you that Bill Beryl died yesterday. His wife called some friends and asked them to see if I would help with what was going on. Kathy and I shot over to the hospital, the Passavant, went into the emergency room, and there was Carol and some other friends and family members. And I embraced her and just held her. And then I leaned over and I said quietly into her ear, Kathy and I will be praying for you without ceasing. And she stepped back and looked at me and said, that's the word we're memorizing for this month. Be joyful always. Pray without ceasing, or pray continually. Rejoice in all circumstances. For this is the will, this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Have you got that memorized yet? Can you imagine we're standing there with her dead husband in one of those little rooms there, and she is reciting that back to me? To know, to be able to pray unceasingly, to know that Kathy and I will be praying for her, to be able to take that word of God. But the direct application of having God's word is this, that whatever the circumstance it is that comes at you, to be able to know God's truth, not the spin of the world, not the attitude of your friends or family members, but to know what God has to say. So yesterday I participated in a funeral, Sunday, yesterday, of a woman who was the first Christian, knowingly, that I met when Kathy and I moved to Sewickley. Back in those days, I had the hair and the guitar and all that jazz, and had a band, was actually asked to perform at a wedding reception. I actually said to the mother of the bride, do you really want me to perform? You know what it is I have to sing about. She said, that's what I'd like you to do. So I did a couple of my songs, and one of them I spoke about just briefly, and that it had to do with Jesus. The woman who we buried yesterday at age 94, going back now something like about 39 years, came up to me at that wedding reception, and she drew me to one side. She said, do you believe in Jesus? She didn't know I was a minister undercover. She didn't know that I dearly loved Jesus. Do you believe in Jesus? It was so great at her funeral yesterday to be able to point people to the Jesus that she knew. She wasn't raised to know Jesus. She had a woman come in as an artist and sketch the kids and as little beautiful young people in color do these crayon portraits of the children. But the woman who came in from Boston to do that was a believer in Jesus, and while she's sketching the kids, leads the mother, Ginny Nix, to the Lord. Wife of Dr. Bob Nix. And she couldn't contain it. So she began to invite other women in to have a Bible study. For over 35 years, she led a Bible study. And that was really countercultural in Sewickley in those days. She was the first living, breathing, witnessing Christian that we ran into. This morning, her son, who is now an Episcopal minister, is in the congregation here. Wherever you are, Chip Nix, and I think, did I see David Nix as well out here somewhere? Will you guys stand up if you're here, and we'd just like to say hello and God bless you. There's Chip, anyway. That was the beginning of the rest of his life. He came back from Vietnam and got to know Jesus and went into the ministry. It started with his mother. And it started with a faithful artist who knew Jesus. But what was so much fun yesterday is to tell all these old friends that the love of Christ constrained Ginny to do this. This reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, where it says, the love of Christ constrains me. The love of Christ constrained Ginny to share the love of Jesus with her friends. And the same can be true for you. If you know and believe that God's word is absolute truth, you're coming up against all kinds of garbage. You know, we've got our students sitting down here at the front, the kind of garbage even out of your teachers' mouths, let alone the other kids, or the stuff you see on the internet or in the radio, on the radio or in television. But to know what God's word has to say, and when people run into any kind of need, to be able to tell them what God's word says, and know that when you speak, you are speaking his truth, not your opinion. The world is desperate for the light of the knowledge of the truth in the face of Jesus Christ. And you have the word of God and that word of truth at your disposal. Get into it. And not only so then, but may the love of Christ constrain you. And whenever bad news comes your way or some great opportunity comes your way, you know what God's promises are to you, so that you can trust him. One of the men in my Bible study, it's not my Bible study, there's a group of men I meet with every Tuesday mornings at King's in Wexford, which is our other office from the church. And up there we have a Bible study, a group of us guys together each Tuesday morning. And one of the guys, because he'd memorized that very first verse, Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, which says, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. You remember that? You're all looking at me like, yeah, kinda. He said, I've started not just to read the scriptures in the morning, but to read them at night before I go to bed. Because it said to meditate on them day and night. Well, that really convicted me. Because my wife and I read them together in the morning. I've started now as a habit on account of the promise of that verse to read them at night as well. And to meditate on them before I go to bed. So that I'm careful to do all that's written in them. And then what does it say? Then God will see that you prosper and have success. That's a promise of God. So Jesus, because he is alive, comes to you this morning, if you're willing to open up your mind and your heart to him and authenticate for you that the Old Testament is his word and the New Testament is his word and this Bible is his word for you. Now, given that gift, why would you not devote yourself to finding out what it has to say and then endeavoring to live by it? And I know the spiritual battle that is, and Satan will bring tiredness or whatever else it is into your life to make you so busy or so discouraged or so worn out or so distracted that you're not willing to take that kind of time. And you are the loser. God's got a gift for you, all wrapped up in his word. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, because you are alive, we can trust this word You validated it, lived your life by it, called us to understand it and believe it. And our prayer is, Lord, that by your Spirit you would open our minds to it and set our hearts on fire in response to it. So thank you for this time together. And our prayer is, as we go from here, that you will absolutely inspire us, that you have given us the truth. And we pray this for your name's sake. Amen.
Been listening to a message delivered by Dr. John Guest, the pastor of Christ Church at Grove Farm in Sewickley, Pennsylvania. Christ Church meets at 249 Duff Road in Sewickley, and we'd love to have you join us. For service times and information, call us at area code 412-741-4900. That's 412-741-4900. You may also contact us at that number if you have a spiritual need or question. Christ Church is dedicated to reaching out to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the world around us, to help us grow in our faith, and to find our personal ministry. Thank you for listening.
So may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you. Grant you his rest, his peace. So may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and go with you and bless you. All God's people said, Amen.